Okay, so I promised a while ago to explain the maths behind the Heisenberg Uncertainty Principle, and I'm finally going to do it now. To understand this video, you're going to need to know about something called the Fourier Transform. If you don't, and you have no intention of knowing, then feel free to skip this video. Otherwise, I've made two videos explaining it, so watch those if you'd like. Okay, I'm going to assume that we're all on the same page now. Today's discussion is going to center around one really important position wave function. If you've watched my last video, then you'll already be well acquainted with it. It is the complex exponential, i.e., the function whose real part is a cos wave of wavelength 2 pi on k, and its imaginary part is a sine wave with the same wavelength. Okay, now is probably a good time for me to make an apology. Yes, this wave function has imaginary numbers in it. In general, all wave functions do. I never mentioned it because it wasn't very important up until now. Trust me though, the ideas are still straightforward. Okay, so let's go back to our exponential. What's so special about having a position wave function like this? As you well know, usually if we try to measure the momentum of a particle, we're uncertain about what value we'll get. However, the weird thing is that if a particle's position wave function is a complex exponential like this, then we know without a doubt exactly what momentum we'll get. In fact, the value we'll get is k times h bar. This is called the de Broglie hypothesis, and honestly, this is the only mysterious part of this episode. As you'll see, the de Broglie hypothesis is all you need to make the uncertainty principle happen. I don't know why it's true. For now, we can just take it as an experimental fact. But hopefully, in the future, we'll come back to it. For now, I'm going to show you how we can use this fact to find the momentum wave function. Okay, so we now know that if a particle has this kind of position wave function, it certainly will have momentum h bar k. What about if the wave function is some kind of superposition like this? Well, then, if we measure the momentum of the particle, it will either be h bar k1 or h bar k2. The probability of measuring either depends on the size of these coefficients. The bigger the coefficients, the more likely the value is. A similar thing works no matter how big the superposition is. Therefore, if we're given a random wave function and we want to know what the momentum is most likely to be, our first task should be to write the function as a superposition of exponential functions and then look at the coefficients. But wait. Isn't this exactly what the Fourier transform is good at doing? Remember that if we want to decompose a function into exponentials, the Fourier transform is basically the thing that tells us how much of each of the exponentials we have. Therefore, if we look at the Fourier transform of a function and see it's very peaked at a point, it means the weights on the exponentials in that range are very high. But that means that the probability of getting the corresponding momentums is also high. Well then, a more convenient version of this graph is to multiply all these k values by h bar, because that gives us the momentums using the de Broglie hypothesis. In this version of the graph, I can find out how likely a certain range of momentums are by just looking at how big the graphs are around there. But that means that this graph is in fact the momentum wave function. So all we have to do to get from the position wave function to the momentum one is to take the Fourier transform and then multiply all these k values by h bar. Okay, so this is the link between momentum and position in quantum mechanics, but what's so special about it? Remember, the uncertainty in a variable is measured by the width of the wave function, or more precisely, its standard deviation. The uncertainty principle basically says that you can't make the uncertainty in position and the uncertainty in momentum arbitrarily small at the same time. Well, it turns out that this is just a property of the Fourier transform. Say we have some function with uncertainty delta x, and its Fourier transform has uncertainty delta p. Let's try and make the uncertainty in the function smaller by squishing the function to make its uncertainty go down by a factor of d. Now, surely the product of uncertainty has gone down because delta x has been reduced. Unfortunately, the Fourier transform thwarts us. You see, the Fourier transform now spreads out, so its uncertainty goes up by a factor of d. Therefore, the product of uncertainty doesn't decrease at all, despite our best efforts. It's pretty straightforward to show that this will happen no matter what type of function we're using the formulas for the Fourier transform, but we'll look at some examples instead. This function is the hat function. As you can see, its Fourier transform is pretty crazy. As we squish the hat, though, the Fourier transform gets more and more spread out. A similar thing happens if you start out with a Gaussian function. So you see, it's this property that if a function is lean, then its Fourier transform is wide, and vice versa, that causes the position-momentum uncertainty. Let's just try one last Bayne time to defy the uncertainty principle. Let's go back and look at the function e to the ikx. If this is a particle's position wave function, then what is its momentum wave function? Well, we know without a doubt that the particle will have momentum h bar k, so its momentum wave function is just a huge spike at h bar k. In other words, the uncertainty in momentum is zero. But if delta p is zero, then delta p times delta x must be zero, so the uncertainty principle is wrong, right? Not quite. If we actually calculate the position uncertainty, we'll find that it's infinite. But this is very weird, because this means that if the momentum is perfectly known, and we try and measure its position, then the particle is equally likely to turn up anywhere in the universe. I think this is utterly ridiculous. So then, is it actually possible to get a particle into a state where we know its momentum perfectly? Well, last episode I told you that if we measure a particle's momentum, it collapses into a state of only having that momentum. So then, my conclusion is that it's impossible to measure the momentum of a particle 100% precisely, even in theory, because that would allow the particle to turn up anywhere. We can use pretty similar logic to conclude that we can't perfectly measure a particle's position either. So from now on, when we talk about measuring a particle in a certain spot or with a certain momentum, what we really mean is that it approximately has that value. Well, that's it for our discussion of the uncertainty principle for a bit. I'll see you next time for some more quantum mechanics though.